Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts, I pray.
To Clower Union Church. I'm Michael Horning. I'm one of the deacons here. And as most of you know, Kahu Allen is still on sabbatical. A couple more weeks and we'll have him back. But we are so blessed. We have Reverend Scott Landis all the way from the island of Maui. He's going to give us our message today and communion. So, and speaking of communion, for those who haven't been with us before, I want to make sure everybody's got a communion packet that wants one. Okay. So when the time comes for doing communion, we do it a little differently. So you'll take out your stuff, open your alcohol wipe, wipe down your hands, wipe down the container, make sure no germs are on it. And then very carefully you peel off the top clear film to get to the wafer. And this will be after Nkahu goes through the elements and he'll get his out and we'll all do it at the same time. So we'll peel it back, he'll say eat, we'll take the wafer. And then don't squeeze the container as you pull back the foil because you'll get the juice all over you. And we don't want that. So, and then when you're done, if you wouldn't mind putting everything back in the baggie, sealing it up, that will keep us from getting it all over our furniture. I want to thank the Kauai Parade participants for a wonderful parade yesterday, especially Mo. Melissa, you did an awesome job. You should be a car salesman. Most of the announcements are on page 6 in your bulletin, but I'll point out a few of them. Prayers and Squares have a quilt auction that's going to be given away on Father's Day. So they have tickets, $5 per ticket, $10 for 3 tickets. So you can see Bonnie, and she'll set you up with that. And then Prayers and Squares will be meeting this Tuesday, I believe it is, in the newly demoed kitchen that Dan worked quite hard with. We've got the wall down. We're ready for them to start building our new kitchen. So that's going to be great. Like I said, most of the readings are in here. We do not pass around an offering bowl, just doing COVID times, we stopped that, and now we've decided, it's everybody's got some type of germ, so let's not do it. But if the message moves you and you'd like to help us out here at Kauai Union Church, we have a bowl up here on the communion table, and we have a basket outside the door. You could drop off a donation there. Other than that, I think it's time for call to worship, and we'll get Tiffany to fill in. Because Ezra is in the bulletin, but he couldn't make it today, so.
Our call to worship. Listen, for your name is being called. Beyond the range of human voices, God is calling. Listen for the unfamiliar voice that you have ignored. Listen for the solemn charge God gives. Wonderful are the thoughts and works of God. God's light is ready to shine in our hearts. Shall we pray? Speak to us, O God, for your servants are trying to listen. Amid the noisy claimants for your attention, our ears tingle at the prospect that you leave a message for us. Here we are, gathered that you might search us and know us. We are wonderfully made in your image. Inspire us to live up to that image. Show us how to proclaim Jesus Christ in our daily decisions so we can witness your love through deeds of kindness and words that empower. Amen.
To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, 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 and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time to weep. To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, 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 and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to build up, a time to break down, a time to dance, a time to mourn, a time to cast away stones, a time to gather stones together. To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time for every purpose under heaven. A time of love, a time of hate, a time of war, a time of peace, a time you may embrace and not embrace from each other. To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to gain, a time to lose, a time to rend, a time to sow, a time to love, a time to hate, a time for peace. I swear it's not too late. To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time for every purpose under heaven.
Today's scripture reading is from Mark chapter 2, verses 23 through chapter 3, verse 6. Listen to the word of God. Jesus is Lord of the Sabbath. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as his disciples walked along, they began to pick some heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, they are doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath." He answered, "Have you ever read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need? In the days of Abiathar, the high priest, he entered in the house of God and ate the consecrated bread, which is lawful only for priests to eat. And he also gave some to his companions. Then he said to them, 'The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even on the Sabbath.' Jesus heals on the Sabbath. Another time, Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, 'Stand up in front of everyone.' Then Jesus asked him, 'Which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill?' But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and, deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts, said to the man, 'Stretch out your hand.' He stretched it out, and his hand was completely restored. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus. May God bless the reading of the word, and may your hearts be open to it.
I just want to take a few moments to thank you for inviting me to this church
And let me tell you a little story. Almost 20 years ago was my first trip to Hawaii. And my first island was Kauai. I came down to Poipu and had a vacation there with some friends, and I fell in love. Oh my goodness. So while I make my home now in Maui, you know your first love. And every time I come back here, it's just such a, I get chicken skin just talking about it and thinking about it. Being well hosted by Ellen and Taka, dear friends from the Kealakea Church over in Maui. Yesterday we took a ride up to the North Shore, and to see the rain and the waterfalls and the mist and the greenery, we just don't get that in Kihei. it's very brown and very dry. So it's so nice to be back here, and so nice. I drove past this church so many times wondering what it was and what it was like, and now I get to preach in it. So this is a dream come true, and I'm so delighted to be here. I hope I can contain myself enough to make some sense out of the scripture passage for today. The other thing I want to say before I begin, and this is very important, thank you for your faithful witness as a open and affirming United Church of Christ marching in the Pride Parade. That is so important. I can't tell you how important that is. Give yourselves a hand. That is so important to so many young lives who wonder, and old lives who wonder, if the church is just filled with hypocrites today. So they know when they see churches participating in something like a pride parade that you stand for something important in our culture today. I'll talk a little bit about that in my sermon, but I just want to thank you as someone who has participated in many pride parades throughout my life. I'm so glad that you're still standing in faithful witness. And finally, congratulations on your 100 years of existence. I always look out in the back and say, oh my gosh, it's 100 years. I had forgotten that you celebrated your centennial. So congratulations to you for all those years of being a faithful witness here in Kauai. Let us pray. O holy God of many years of faithful witness, God of pride parades, and God of this moment of worship, we bow before you with hearts open. I come before you with a humble heart, hoping to break open the word in ways that make sense, and may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. My husband and I are football fanatics. I mean, we will watch any football game at the drop of a hat. So you come to our house come this fall on a Saturday or Sunday, you're likely to see us lounged out watching any football game that we want to see, even though neither one of us ever played the sport. We become students of the sport. So we enjoy finding out about the players' lives. We enjoy studying their plays and the tactics and techniques of how to win a game. What we don't like is the amount of time it takes to watch an entire football game. So, we have become masters at clicking through our menu on the smart TV and recording the games in advance that we want to see, and you know where I'm going with this. When we watch a game, we both fight over it, one of us has the remote control, and we fast forward through all the commercials. You can even fast forward through the huddles, you don't need to see that. And you can actually watch an entire football game in about an hour and 15 minutes. So that way we get to watch more football games on any given weekend. I tell you that both to kind of give you a little bit of insight and knowledge of who I am, but also secretly wondering if there are any other crazy football fanatics here in our congregation today. There we go, we got a few hands. But more importantly, to say that my method of watching a football game, you're going to have to hold with me on this for a while, is very similar to Mark's method of writing the gospel. Mark has his thumb on the fast forward button, just like I do when I'm watching a football game. He completely eliminates any birth narrative in his gospel. Fast forward. And then very quickly, he has Jesus beginning his public ministry, getting right to his baptism, and ready, go, fast forward. And then he begins to heal folks. By the time we get to chapter 2 of Mark's gospel, he's already in conflict with the religious authorities, who realize that there's a problem that they have with this guy, and they plan with the dominant political party to get rid of him. Fast forward. This all happens in Mark in the first two chapters. More interested in doing what was pono, what was expected, Jesus jumps right in. And he gets himself into what the late Congressman John Lewis called good trouble. Time and again, Jesus got himself into good trouble, which seemed to be his destiny, and he did so very quickly. You may be wondering why this situation was such a big deal to the Pharisees, if you listen closely. Jesus and his disciples were merely out walking on the Sabbath, and the Pharisees who joined them watched very closely to see how Jesus would react when his disciples started to pick some heads of grain as they went along their way. Known for their strict adherence to the law and insistence upon the law, they expected all others to follow suit. And they were wary of this new rabbi who seemed to be doing things a little differently. So they noticed when Jesus didn't reprimand his disciples for picking the grains as they walked on this solemn day of rest. Instead, when he was questioned about their lack of discipline, he cited a story from their book of worship, the Hebrew Scriptures. And he reminded them of David, when David and his soldiers were starving and they saw the showbread on the altar, just like this one here. They saw it as they were walking by, and that was sanctified bread set apart for God that only the priests could consume. But David said, they're hungry. They need to eat. And they ate it. Plot thickened. If picking a few grains of wheat on the Sabbath was a problem, healing someone made them even more furious. And to make matters worse, he did so right in the synagogue. To the Pharisees, this was like Jesus taking that action and making a mockery of their law. After all, their commandments were made to specifically say to adhere to rest on the Sabbath. No work. Keep it holy. We might read that and say, what's the big deal? You know, it's not that the notion of breaking the law was all that bad. They realized that that was an honorable thing to do, to keep the Sabbath, to rest, to keep it holy. And we would all probably agree, even in our culture, that we've lost sight of that in our 24/7, never stop, always on, always open for business society. But what the Pharisees could not comprehend is the deeper reality that sometimes laws need to be broken, or at best bent just a little. I was reared in southeastern Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania Dutch culture. It's a beautiful place to call home. I always say to people, it's a beautiful place to be from. The largest religion, or denomination, I guess you would call it, in my area were the Mennonites. Anybody familiar with the Mennonites? Very, very strict culture, and one of their hallmarks was pacifism, which I really admired. But the Mennonites, especially what we called the Black Bumper Mennonites and the Conservative Mennonites, these were ones that were austere, and they were very strict on their way of living. Even though a lot of this wasn't in the Bible, they had rules that you had to follow. So, no dancing, no card playing, no alcohol, no movies, some would add no fun, was very much a part of Mennonite lifestyle. The Mennonites were fierce advocates of keeping the Sabbath, which was Sunday in our community, Saturday in the story we read today. So on the Sabbath, there were no stores that were open in my neighborhood. There were no restaurants that were open, very few gas stations, and no organized activities like soccer or baseball or even football. Sundays were completely dedicated to rest and for visiting relatives. That's what we did. We went around visiting on Sundays. After church, get in the car, and we'd go and visit. Going someplace for a big Sunday dinner, which is sandwiched between morning worship and evening worship. No one worked on that day, except for the women. The women were tasked with preparing the big feasts when we went to visit. Somehow they were exempt from Sabbath, a reality that I could never quite figure out. I hasten to admit that I am from this culture, which shaped a lot of who I am, but in which I never fully fit. Even as a kid, I noticed this lack of parity, and I asked questions about that and would often get stern looks. You just knew they were stereotypic gendered roles that had to be kept, never given any answers. On one occasion, we gathered at my in-laws, who lived on a big farm, for a large family reunion. You guessed it was on a Sunday. The men sat around in lawn chairs talking story while the women worked feverishly to prepare the meal for the day. Cousins ran all over the farm having a great time in the barn, out of the barn, running through the house until my middle son went running through what was a closing glass door which slammed on him. I heard the crash, then the scream, and immediately went into action. When I'm in a crisis or when I am afraid, I become a control freak. And I took Derek and I laid him on the ground immediately, and then I ordered people to do things. I ordered my father-in-law to go get some towels. You would never order my father-in-law to do anything. Ordered my mother-in-law to call 911 as I held Derek's chest together, which was severely, severely cut. The ambulance came shortly thereafter. It seemed like only minutes till the paramedics got there, and then Janet, I, and the grandparents all loaded up in cars and went to the ER. I'll spare you the details, but after a quick evaluation and emergency surgery, they removed 7 large shards of glass from Derek's chest cavity. 107 stitches later, he only has the scars today to talk about it. Some were even scissored around his aorta. It was a miracle. But as I recall the story in light of this gospel text, I am very thankful that there were people working on the Sabbath. Sometimes the Sabbath ought to be kept because we're so stressed out and so tired and so worn, we need a place to come and just sit and be still and know God. But sometimes God bless the medical staff in that hospital, no matter how tired they were or what dinner they had to leave to be there, they were there to save my son's life. Sometimes rules need to be broken. If we didn't have rules or laws to help order our lives, we would live in chaos. Anarchy is not the answer. It's when we cannot see beyond the rule and into the face of human need that we can get ourselves in trouble. Jesus was not trying to make fools out of the Pharisees for their law. He merely wanted to expose the impracticality of slavish adherence to it. Fortunately, there are prophets that continue to emerge even in our day to help us make those distinctions, to help us see with the lenses of justice and love, even if that means ignoring the law. In our religious history, we have people like Martin Luther, who decried the sale of indulgences of the Catholic Church to free followers of their sins while the church amassed huge sums of money. He could see beyond the law into the eyes of human need. We've seen it in men and women who have taken similar stands against rules and the way we always do things. People like the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., John Lewis, Malcolm X, Mother Teresa, Nelson Mandela, Dorothy Day, John McCain, Harvey Milk, Gloria Steinem, and countless others who insisted on justice and often in opposition to prescribed or proposed law. There is a time for everything. And sometimes as people of faith, as followers of Jesus, we need to stand up and speak out against institutionalized injustice whose laws firmly protect the privileged majority while overlooking often the needs of the marginalized. Laws which incidentally get increasingly strengthened as that majority tends to lose ground and tends to lose power. Once again, I am not advocating any form of anarchy. Rules are in place for a reason. I recall once we were in Mexico, in La Paz, Mexico, driving. And I quickly learned that in La Paz and in lots of places in Mexico, stop signs are a suggestion. So, it's not a law. You just kind of keep on going if no one's coming. I'm not advocating for that at all. Stop signs in our lives are there for a reason. They sometimes inform us and inform what we ought to do, what is normal, what helps order society. But sometimes you got to march in a parade and say that injustice continues. And we cannot stand for that when injustice is given to anyone. Then there is not justice for all. That's something we can't fast forward through. That's something that takes time and work, the ability to listen, and the ability to stand like Martin Luther said, "Here I stand, I can do no other." Sometimes we have to put our foot forward and say what we believe and do what we believe as we hold love and justice together in our prayer. I pray that we all have the courage to do that. It's hard work. It doesn't just happen. It takes a community. It takes a prophet to guide us, but it takes a community to get the work done. Listen to your spiritual heart. You know when there is an injustice. Speak to others. Check it out. Find out where love needs to be given, where love needs to be offered. that all may live in peace. Amen. It's not. Let me say, it doesn't escape you that that message comes on the heels of that which brings us together around the table, where no one is excluded. A table that is welcoming. A table that says no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. This table is the feast of God. We're all children, coming from the north and the south and the east and the west, gather around celebrating the gift of love and justice for all people. And so we remember that Jesus called his disciples, blessing them, and saying, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart. Here you will find rest for your souls. I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger. She that believes in me will never thirst. The one who comes to me, I will not cast out. And so we remember that night. That night that started this whole meal that we celebrate to this day. The night when Jesus took the bread, blessed and broke it, and said, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise with the cup. He raised it and gave it to his disciples, offering it to them, saying, take and drink. This is the cup of blessing given for you in remembrance of me. Each time you drink it, remember me. Often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we do proclaim our Lord's life, death, and resurrection until he comes again. So with those who have gone before us and those who will follow us, we can proclaim that Christ is risen. Christ has died. Christ will come again. Let us pray. God, we ask your blessing upon these elements and all those that we hold in our hands. We ask that you would give them to us as encouragement to strengthen our spiritual lives as well as our physical lives. We ask that you would bless us to be your people of love and justice in all that we do. And as we are reminded we are welcomed at your table, we can go forth and welcome others. Help us to see the eyes of human need, to give our love to each one. Our aloha be present here in this meal and as we serve you through Christ our Savior. Haven't already done so.
blessing of Holy Communion strengthen you, support you, encourage you in your faith.
Change my heart, O God.
Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. Change my heart, O God.
prayer request? Okay, very good. Thank you. We have a couple of prayer requests here that I want to make sure that we acknowledge. One is a prayer request for Yoni dealing with weakness and testing after being positive for COVID. Prayers for Yoni's daughter and caregiver, Val. So a prayer there. And also a happy birthday to a very special lady, Judith. Can we sing happy birthday? Stay for cake. Can we sing happy birthday now? Birthday is it?
21.
Yeah, yeah? 87? Oh, you look fabulous. Good. We're going to stay for cake after church, yeah? Oh, wonderful. Okay. Well, thank you. And I thank you so much again for inviting me to be with you today. It really has been it is a pleasure. It's not been a pleasure. It is a pleasure. And I'm grateful to have this time, not only to preach, but to pray with you. That's really much more important to me than me just pontificating. So this is a time to offer whatever is on our hearts to God. We'll do so. I'll give a few moments of silence as we begin. I'll also pause at one point in my prayer, and if you want to lift up a name verbally, feel free to do that. Sometimes people, you know, will say names at the same time. That's fine. God has big ears and can hear us all. So we'll just have a time of prayer, and then we'll conclude together with the Lord's Prayer. Epule kako, let us pray. God of waves and bird song, God of beautiful solos and duets, tula, piano, God of our hearts and God of our lives, it is so good to pause in this time of worship and listen. It is so good and important to listen to our hearts for your guidance. Oh, that we would see the needs of this world and be vigilant in our efforts to help. Oh, that we would acknowledge our own needs and perhaps lament, express our grief and sorrow. Oh, that you would encourage us to offer our praise and joy. We thank you for this time together. For it is not mere happenstance that we all come to Kaloa Union on this Sunday. We know we are here for a reason. Help us to see and to know what that reason is. We pray for each person here today, those that have been mentioned, those that are listed in our bulletin, and I pray for Pastor Kahu Allen as he continues on sabbatical. Continue to give him the rest and recuperation that he needs, the refreshment to come back to serve this place which he loves. And remember, help us to remember to continue to pray for him all the days on his time away. Lord, we pray for peace where there is such deep division, whether it be in our state or our country and throughout our world. We pray for places that are completely ravaged with war and wonder, will we ever learn? Pray especially for the areas of Palestine and Israel, Ukraine, and all other areas where there is so much devastation and need. Finally, we pray for ourselves as you tap us on the shoulder to serve you in new ways. May we be led by your Spirit. May we be guided to help those that we hold in our hearts. And so we lift their names to you now, either verbally or in the silence of our hearts. For Bob and Santino. May your blessing be upon each one of our petitions. And hear us now as we offer this prayer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Turn with me, please, as we stand for our final song. My hope is built on nothing less, number 403 in the Black Book.
Thank you.
Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all God's children. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be unified with each one now and forever. Amen.
You're all the way down.